Now, we're talking about Muhammad, and the question is whether Muhammad is mentioned in the Bible. Put your hand up if you've heard this claim before, that Muhammad is in the Bible. And keep your hand up if you heard it from an Islamic person or friend that you know. Okay. So some of you will be a bit familiar with the arguments. Now, when you look this up on the internet or you do research about this or you read some of their literature, they claim many, many verses in the Old and New Testament relate to Muhammad, either directly or very subtly. Now, I'm not going to go through all their arguments because there's so many and we have a time limit tonight for obvious reasons, but I will look at the main ones. And the two main ones relate to one in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 18, and one in the New Testament, John 14. But before we go into the scriptures and deal with the arguments step by step, let's have a bit of background about who Muhammad is, where he came from, what he did during his lifetime, etc. Well, Muhammad was born on the 26th of April in the year 570, and he died on the 8th of June 632. So he lived for 62 years, which is almost twice the length of Jesus Christ's life on earth. Muhammad, as a word, as a name, means the praised one. And I think we'll come back and we'll touch on that later on. Now, Muhammad claimed, and his followers certainly perpetuate this claim, to be the last and the greatest in the line of prophets sent by God or sent by Allah. And we'll see later on, this is one of their arguments, that Muhammad is in the line of Abraham, Moses, Jesus, etc. And if our talk tonight was on the topic, who was the greatest, Jesus or Muhammad, well, we'll actually stop at that claim and we'll examine it, whether Muhammad really is greater than Jesus or not, from the evidence that we do have from Christian and Islamic sources. Now, Muhammad was the son of a fellow named Abdullah Hashim, who died actually 6 months before Muhammad was born. And Muhammad's mother died when he was six. So he was left as an orphan at the age of six. So then he got attached to his uncle, who was called Abu Talib. While traveling with his uncle on caravan trains to Syria, Muhammad is said to have met a Christian monk named Buhayra, who foretold Muhammad's prophethood. Now, this is an Islamic, we might call it legend. When I mean legend, I don't mean made up story or fantasy. Legend traditionally means something that's worthwhile reading, from the Latin legge, read. So this Islamic legend claimed that still as a boy, somewhere around the age of 10, plus or minus 10, 11 or 12, Buhayra predicted that this young boy will one day be a great prophet of God. And I'm not saying that that's a true story, but that's the claim that they make. In his early years, Muhammad was simple in his habits and careful in his external appearance. He was imaginative, affectionate, and magnanimous towards personal and family friends. On the negative side, Muhammad had an acute aversion to pain. Apparently, he suffered a condition that some believe was akin to epilepsy and was rather nervous in temperament. Now, Muhammad married at the age of 25. That was his first marriage, which he remained faithful to until the death of his wife. He married a wealthy widow named Khadija, who was 15 years his senior. So Muhammad was 25, Khadija at the time was 40. They together had six children. Only one of those children survived Muhammad, and that was his daughter, the youngest, Fatima. This marriage is very good for Muhammad. It probably stabilized him, but it gave him the opportunities to develop himself while dealing with his wife's business interests, his ability to deal with other people, to talk the talk. You know, he became a real people's person, so to speak, in today's language. So promoting his wife's business interests, Muhammad grew in confidence and stature, developing commercial savvy and a flair for communication. Now, what religion was Muhammad before he claimed to have revelations from the angel Gabriel? Well, Muhammad was a believer in one God. Now, the situation in Arabia in the beginning of the, or the end of the 6th century, the beginning of the 7th century, was very mixed and very confused. There were strongholds of Jewish cities and colonies. There were settlements of Christians sporadically spread throughout the Arabian Peninsula. To the northwest, there was the Byzantine Empire. But Christianity in the east was severely split. By the end of the 6th century, when Muhammad's just around 30 years of age, Christianity in the east is fragmented. You had the Arian heresy, you had the Monophysite heresy coming out of Egypt, you had the Nestorian heresy. So it was all split. And this is important to know as historical background because it gives some explanation for the very rapid success, the military success that Islam was to enjoy against Eastern Christianity in the years immediately after the death of Muhammad. But of course, the main religion, in inverted commas, in Saudi Arabia at this time was really paganism, polytheistic paganism. But Muhammad was different. He was not, strictly speaking, a pagan of that type. He was a worshipper of one God, and the Muslims have a name for people like that, and they were the Hanifs. So Muhammad was a Hanif, a believer in one God only. As a Hanif, Muhammad was zealous and austere. He would often wander in the hills for weeks on end around Mecca, meditating in solitude. It was in the year 610, when he was 40 years of age, that Muhammad's life changed forever. One night, known subsequently as the Night of Power, Muhammad claimed to receive a visitation from the angel Gabriel while in the cave called Hira on Jabal al-Nur. The angel, it is claimed, said to him, quote, "You are the messenger of God." Muhammad would claim continuous revelations from the angel Gabriel for the next 22 years until his death. Muhammad's first convert was his wife, Khadija. Now, there are different accounts here and they don't all agree. The Sunni account is that when Muhammad first received this claimed apparition, he was rather shaken up somewhat. You'd understand that. I guess if any of us saw an angel or claimed to see an angel, it would shake us up. The Shiite tradition is rather, not simpler, but straight to the point. Muhammad received this and received it with joy and confidence. He was not nervous or shaken about it at all. But Muhammad explained this revelation to Khadija, and she allegedly calmed Muhammad down and was the first one to say to him, "Yes, you are that messenger of God," and she was his first believer. Soon enough, Muhammad converted all his family. His first followers numbered 40. Now, Khadija had a Christian cousin. And by the way, I should add this here. Muhammad's marriage to Khadija may well have been a Christian marriage. Remember, 25, 15 years before claiming to receive this revelation from the angel Gabriel, there was no Islam. There was no Islamic marriage for Muhammad. So one could speculate, we don't know for certain, that maybe that marriage to Khadija was at least officiated by a Christian. Well, anyway, Khadija had a Christian cousin, Waraka bin Nawfil. This fellow also encouraged Muhammad to publicly proclaim the messages he claimed to receive. He said that he recognized those type of messages as akin to Moses' messages. Now, Muhammad's charisma and leadership ability convinced his early followers to sever all ties with birthplace and clan. Now, this is more significant than we realize, because the culture of Arabia at that time was heavily based on tribal and clan allegiances. And if you read the history of Muhammad's military struggles to gain ascendancy in Arabia, he had to fight these tribes and clans. So Muhammad was revolutionary, and it testifies to his personal charisma that he could gain people's allegiances to the extent of compelling them to turn their backs on their traditional tribal and clan allegiances. This enabled the early Muslims to survive ostracism, persecution, and exile from the local Meccans, that is the inhabitants of Mecca. Muhammad was driven out of Mecca for attacking heathenism in AD 622. And this flight from Mecca is known as the Hijra. Now, what was the core of religious practice in Mecca at this time? Was the Kaaba, what the Muslims considered to be their central place of pilgrimage today. That's pre-Islamic. There were up to 365 different idols residing at the Kaaba at this time, representing a pagan deity. One of those pagan deities was Allah, the god of the moon. Now, Allah had a type of ascendancy over the other gods. He was the chief god for many over the others. And one could speculate here, and don't quote me on this as fact, but one could speculate that Muhammad, knowing this, would seize upon this and say, this God that you claim to be your highest God, Allah, is actually not only the highest, but the only God. Akin to what St. Paul did when he was in Athens. They had a monument to the unknown God. St. Paul would seize upon that and say, well, this unknown God you acknowledge is actually the God of the Christians, the Father of Jesus Christ, that you don't yet know, and I'm just here to introduce him to you. Okay, so Muhammad flees to Medina in 622, and it's there in Medina that he's proclaimed a prophet of Allah in that same year. What's Muhammad doing now? Muhammad's now about 52. He's in exile. He's a prophet, and he's building up his supporter base. And he says, what we need to survive, we need money, we need resources. So he approves raids called razias. They're armed raids against caravans traveling between Mecca and Syria. Soon enough, Muhammad would claim revelations or make revelations, making booty and ransom lawful and allotting 1/5 of all spoils obtained to himself. So Muhammad would take 20% of everything that was seized in these military raids against the caravans. In these raids, many innocent merchants were killed. Muhammad was not averse to issuing prophetic revelations suitable to his needs at the moment, whether they were political, legal, or even sexual. At least 27 people were put to death at Muhammad's orders, mostly by assassination. Politically, Muhammad was courageous. He personally fought in battles. A great general and patriotic. Muhammad's military victories began with the Battle of Badr in AD 624. Muhammad rejoiced at the death of his enemies and personally ordered the torture, mutilation, and killing of prisoners who did not accept his prophethood. The prophet was officially the enemy of infidels, that's unbelievers. Fresh revelations describing them as the worst of animals. In all, Muhammad fought in 32 battles and ordered another 61 others. This is historical fact. It's not denied by anybody. This is not, so to speak, anti-Islamic propaganda. This is in the historical record. Muhammad re-entered and conquered Mecca in AD 630 and eventually conquered all Arabian tribes and united Arabia in 632. By all standards, this was an incredible achievement, without a doubt. Particularly at one point when the Muslims were persecuted to such an extent, they actually, most of them left the Arabian Peninsula and settled in what would be today northern part of Somalia on the Horn of Africa and had the protection there of a Christian king in that region at the time. It's an incredible comeback to unite the whole of Arabia by the time of his death. It was through military conquest rather than preaching or miracles that Muhammad brought Arabia under Islam. After the death of his wife Khadija, Muhammad, claiming the rights of a prophet, took at least 12 other wives, including the 7-year-old Aisha, consummating the marriage when she was 9 and he was 53. That's the historical record. Now, of course, by our standards today, some would laugh, ridicule and scorn. Now, I'm not justifying it, but the culture in that day, in that part of the world, this very rustic, tribal, hard-hearted culture, this was in some sense normative. Okay, it wasn't as outrageous as we might think today. Okay, if you think it's outrageous, yes, it is outrageous. But I'm just saying in the context of Arabian society at that time, it wasn't so violently outrageous. It was still extraordinary and out of the norm. But that girl was orphaned. And it was, in a sense, it could be interpreted in one sense and promoted in one sense as an act of charity, taking under his wing a girl that was would otherwise have been left destitute. Okay? But it's not something I personally would agree with or encourage, obviously. In AD 632, Muhammad completed a solemn pilgrimage to Mecca together with 40,000 followers. Soon after, he died of a violent fever at the age of 63. The Quranic scriptures were allegedly dictated to him verbatim by the angel Gabriel. This is their claim that can be historically challenged. An immense following still today reveres his name and teachings, and it's a following that's growing faster than any other religion in the world today. All right, that's just a very brief, very scanty historical background to know something about Muhammad. Our purpose tonight is to ask and answer this question. Is Muhammad mentioned in the Bible? Now, if you claim Muhammad to be a prophet in the line of other prophets of Allah or God, starting with even before Abraham, going back to Noah, going back even to Adam, then you would think that the Old Testament at least should mention something about Muhammad. It's reasonable. You need to establish that, in my opinion, if you want to make the claim that Muhammad is a prophet in the line of all other figures, going back to Adam, Noah, etc. Now, the claim that I'll deal with first of all is the one I've already insinuated. Muhammad is a prophet in the line of Abraham, Moses, and Jesus. That claim is made every day. And it's a bit more audacious than that because the claim is actually Muhammad is not only a prophet in that line, he's the last prophet in that line and he's the greatest prophet in that line. And therefore that puts him over and above Jesus of Nazareth. Which is why it's good to know something about the life of Muhammad objectively, because the sources that I used, they are basically Islamic sources that tell us about Muhammad, and we use Christian sources to tell us about Jesus, and you can come to your own conclusion about, we know who the last is, but it's certainly open for discussion as to who was the greatest. All right. Islam can claim lineage to all the prophets known in the Judeo-Christian tradition, yet it is much more difficult task to prove that claim. So when you encounter people in the future who make this claim, politely, clearly ask them, okay, show me the proof, show me the evidence, okay? After Abraham proved his fidelity to God on Mount Moriah, now that was the episode when Yahweh speaks to Abraham. Abraham's 115 years age at this time. He's 115 years old. 40 years earlier, God had spoken to Abraham when he was 75 and his wife Sarai was 65. And they had no children, and God promised him that one day a new home, and that he'd have descendants numbering as the stars. Okay, that all started when he was 75. 40 years later, well, 25 years later, that son is finally born. Okay, that son is Isaac. He's 100 and Sarah's 90. It was miraculous. That's not natural, as you know. Well, he's only got Isaac when he's 115. He had, of course, Ishmael from his slave servant Hagar. Okay, but they were asked to leave. Too much tension between Hagar and Sarah. And there had to be one line, a clear line of succession. That's Isaac. God tells Abraham, go to Mount Moriah and sacrifice him. Show your fidelity to me. What do you think Abraham's thinking? You want me to sacrifice my own son? He's 115. I'm 115 now. How am I going to have another one? You promised me my descendants will be, my descendants will number as the stars of heaven. But Abraham had trust in God, had faith in God. Despite this confusion that would have been gripping his mind, and as a father, it would have been more than in his mind, you know, somehow he believed that God was going to supply something here or do something to make sure that he would still have these multitudes of descendants. Anyway, Abraham proved his fidelity. And upon proving his fidelity, God spoke the following words to him. From Genesis 22, 17 to 18. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies. And by your descendants shall all the nations of the earth bless themselves. Now, so Abraham was faithful. The angel forestalled Abraham's arm. Isaac wasn't sacrificed. That's all a type of the Father and the Son, when God the Father would sacrifice his only begotten Son out of love for us. This was an actual historical event, but it also was a type in what we call typology, foretelling something greater in the future. But anyway, back on this point here, what is meant by your descendants and all the nations shall bless themselves? So we need to show who the descendants of Abraham will be, and how the world will be blessed, how the nations will be blessed out of the descendants of Abraham. Now, even before Abraham, when we go back 19 chapters earlier to Genesis 3, we have the promise of made by God immediately after the fall of humanity in the garden, that, you know, I'll put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed, etc. And he shall crush your head and you'll lie in wait for his heel. There's already a promise there of someone going to be sent into the world by God who undo the damage caused by Adam. It's that promise. The person in that promise is also the same person promised here in these words. This person promised in Genesis 3 is the person promised here in Genesis 22, who be a descendant of Abraham and will be the cause of blessing for all the nations of the earth. So what do you think many centuries later, probably 18 centuries later, when Christianity has come into the world and the Christians are claiming that Jesus of Nazareth is the fulfillment of Genesis 3 and Genesis 22. Well, the Christians had to show in an apologetical manner, that is, give a reasoned defense, a reasoned explanation for why they believe that Jesus of Nazareth is the promised one in Genesis 3 and Genesis 22. They had to actually show a link, a chain of descendants from Abraham to Jesus of Nazareth. It's like in New South Wales last century, if you want to show that you are the legal title owner of a block of land, you had to show your chain of succession going back to the original land grant from the New South Wales colony. They got rid of that system and made it simpler, but it's the same concept. If I have title, I have to show that I received title from someone who themselves had legal title legitimately, and to go back. So with Jesus, he claims a title. He claims to be the Messiah. He claims to be the son of David. Well, he also claims to be in the going back to Abraham. So the Christians had to go out of their way to prove this. And that's one of the purposes of Matthew's gospel. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 17. We read there that Matthew gives his readers a lineage from Abraham through to David through to Jesus. He gives 14 generations from Abraham to David, 14 generations from David to the Babylonian exile, and then another 14 generations from the Babylonian exile to Jesus of Nazareth. Now, the experts tell us there's a lot more than 3 by 14 here, which would be 42 generations. There's a lot more, actually. I won't go into the explanation as to why. But the Christians went out of their way to show the succession, the lineage. Abraham begat Isaac, who begat Jacob, etc., etc., all the way. Then we get up to Judah, and then we go to Joseph, and then we go to Jesus. Okay, and in all that, we also have King David, etc. Matthew wanted to prove to Jewish readers of his gospel that Jesus was the expected descendant of Abraham. And also, he put 60 prophecies in his gospel from the Old Testament and shows how they were fulfilled by Jesus of Nazareth in his gospel. So here we have Matthew digging the Old Testament up and showing how it's fulfilled in Jesus of Nazareth. In the meantime, he's showing how Jesus was the expected descendant of Abraham, who would be the cause of blessing on all the nations. So Matthew goes out of his way to show that Jesus is that descendant of Abraham. How does he go to show that this same Jesus of Nazareth is the cause of blessing on all the nations? We have the Great Commission in the last chapter of his gospel, where Jesus says to his disciples, "Go forth, baptize all nations in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit." That's how this descendant of Abraham becomes a blessing upon all the nations. It's because Jesus gathers a new 12. We have the 12 tribes of Israel who are the sons of Jacob. We have now a new 12, the disciples, who are the new pillars of a new Israel, a universal Israel, and they're commissioned to go out to the whole world. It's no longer a faith just of Jewish peoples or the descendants, direct descendants of Abraham. It's all nations. Go baptize all nations. That's how all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in Jesus Christ. Now, the challenge is, where can Islamic apologists claiming that Muhammad is a descendant of Abraham and a blessing to all the nations as well, where have they adduced their lineage? Have they shown a direct link, one successive generation, one father begetting another, from Abraham right through to Muhammad? Because I'd have to show a lot longer chain than the chain from Abraham to Jesus, because Muhammad comes 600 years after Jesus. So the challenge for them is, when, if you ever encounter them one-on-one personally, give them time. You claim that Jesus is a descendant of Abraham. Show us the chain. Show us the link. Show us the genealogy here. Show us who are the descendants in by name all the way back to Abraham. That's a challenge I believe they have yet to actually achieve. All right. The next claim. Muhammad was foretold by both Moses and Jesus. Where is this claim made officially? In the Quran, in Surah 7, verse 157, it reads as follows. Those who follow the apostle, the unlettered prophet, whom they find mentioned in their own, in the law and the gospel. So let's look at this claim. Okay, Muhammad is mentioned in the Old Testament. Now, if you go to Islamic websites, etc., as I said earlier in the beginning of this talk, you'll find that there are many, many verses that Muslim apologists seize upon and try and argue that Muhammad is the fulfillment of these verses. I won't go into all of them, but the main one in the Old Testament, as I said earlier, is Deuteronomy 18. What does Deuteronomy 18 say? And who says it? Well, it's Muhammad. It's Moses. Deuteronomy 18, 15 to 18. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brethren. Him you shall heed. I'll raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brethren. And I'll put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. So clearly here, very clearly, Moses is claiming that in the future there will be another prophet like him. Prophet who'll speak what God commands him to speak. And we are to listen to him. Muslims in general are very quick to seize on Deuteronomy 18 and claim that Moses was prophesying about the future coming of Muhammad. Volumes have been written highlighting the following as similarities between Moses and Muhammad. Remember, Moses is saying here, God will raise up another prophet like me. So you have to show that whoever claims to be this latter prophet has to show similarity with Moses. Is there any similarity between Moses and Muhammad? Don't shake your heads, because there is. Let's have a look. And this is serious, okay? We have to take the claim seriously. One, both were married. No. Two, listen to this one, both became prophets at the age of 40. No, I don't think that's funny. They did. They were both called at the age of 40. Well, actually, Moses' calling really came when he was 80. All right? But anyway, definitely Moses leaves Egypt when he's 40. Both were initially rejected by their peoples, went into exile, and returned years later to lead their peoples. That's true. Both were lawgivers, military leaders, spiritual guides to their peoples. Both were succeeded by leaders, namely Joshua and Omar, who conquered the land of Palestine. So there is substance, there is a foundation upon which to make this claim that Muhammad is a prophet like Moses, and we had to listen to him. There are parallels. Christians claim that prophet that Moses foretold that we should listen to is Jesus of Nazareth. Are there any similarities between Moses and Jesus of Nazareth? Let's listen to the following. Both Moses and Jesus were saved by God from slaughters of innocent children launched by jealous kings. Okay. Seti, wanted to control the growing Hebrew population, getting too big, that could be a threat, orders a massacre of newborn Hebrew males. Moses survives. Herod the Great, the megalomaniac, who killed anyone who was even breathed too close to him, had no hesitation killing his own sons if necessary, if he felt they were plotting against him. Here's about this newborn king, sets the soldiers to Bethlehem to kill every male child under the age of two. Jesus survives. They both survive massacres of innocents. Both Moses and Jesus were called out of Egypt. Both of them had been in Egypt. Both of them come out of Egypt. Moses left the right hand of Pharaoh and became a slave to rescue the Hebrews from slavery. Jesus came from the right hand of the Father and became a slave. This is the kenosis passage of St. Paul. Lowered himself, taking the form of a slave, to rescue the world from spiritual slavery. Moses offered a Passover lamb to save the Hebrews from slavery. Jesus was the Passover lamb offered to save the world from spiritual slavery. Moses spent 40 years in the desert before returning to rescue the Hebrews. Jesus spent 40 days in the desert before returning to begin his public mission that rescued humanity. Moses gave the Hebrews in the desert bread from heaven. Jesus gives his followers new bread from heaven, the Eucharist. Moses gave the Hebrews in the desert water from a rock. Jesus gives his followers water that springs up for eternal life. Aaron walked in front of Moses to prepare his way. John the Baptist walked in front of Jesus to prepare his coming. The Hebrews were baptized into Moses in the Red Sea. Christians are baptized into Jesus Christ. Both Moses and Jesus were lawgivers. Moses heralded the covenant of law. Jesus heralded the covenant of grace. God spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai. The Father spoke to Jesus on Mount Tabor at the Transfiguration. Now, it's important here, in looking at it from the Christian perspective, when we look at Moses and we look at Jesus of Nazareth, we have what's called a classical type-antitype comparison. The type is the original. The antitype comes subsequently. The type is the shadow. The antitype is the greater reality. The type and antitype are similar and dissimilar at the same time. You probably felt that when I was reading the comparisons between Moses and Jesus. There were similarities, but there were differences at the same time. And that happens with classical typology. Don't expect the life of Moses and Jesus to be identical in every respect, because then we wouldn't have typology. If they're identical in every respect, the antitype wouldn't be the greater reality. Now, I've just put forward two cases here. The Islamic case as to why Muhammad is the prophet of Deuteronomy 18, and the Christian case as to why Jesus of Nazareth is that prophet of Deuteronomy 18. So the argument goes back and forth. Where is the referee to decide here? Who's the referee? Well, look, let's go one step further here. Our Islamic friends want to later on claim that there is evidence for Muhammad in the New Testament. So they will go to the New Testament and quote the New Testament as an authority that Muhammad was foretold in the New Testament. Well, if you're going to do that, you can't pick and choose your New Testament verses. You can't slice up the New Testament and say, we'll take this, we won't take that. We'll read this, but we'll ignore that. If you're going to go to the New Testament to prove that Muhammad was foretold in the Bible, then let's use the New Testament also to see who was the fulfillment of Deuteronomy 18. Because the New Testament tells us who that was or who that is. Let's first look at Matthew 17, verses 2 to 5. Remember Mount Tabor? God speaks to Jesus on Mount Tabor. I love this story because you have Peter, you have James, you have John. They travel up with Jesus. And Peter's very simple here. You know, there's a simplicity there. He's not a complicated guy. You know, he never did theology, right? He never got a doctorate from anywhere. You know, it's just hanging around with Jesus. And which is what we should do, really. Anyway, but I won't get too political here. But something happens on Mount Tabor. It's called the Transfiguration. An enormous light comes through Jesus. What we see here is really what lies under the flesh, what lies hidden under the human nature of Jesus, his divinity. But that's not the point here we're trying to make. That's not the argument we're trying to establish. Listen to what voice is spoken above. We'll relate the whole passage. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his garments became as light. Lo, a bright cloud overshadowed them, Peter, James, John. And a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." Those words. God is saying, listen to him. Let's go back to Deuteronomy 18. Moses says, him you shall heed. It's another way of saying this prophet, listen to him. Who also appears with Jesus on Mount Tabor? You have the voice of the Father who says, listen to him. Who else is there? Yes, do you know? Moses and Elijah. Why? Because Moses represents the law and Elijah represents the prophets. Because there were the Hebrew Bible, the Jewish Bible is made up into three major parts. The law, the prophets and the writings. You take the Hebrew letters representing those three, you form an acronym, another Hebrew word, Tanakh. That was the name for the Jewish Bible, the Hebrew Bible. The Tanakh, the law, the prophets and the writings. Who represents the law? Moses. Who represents the prophets? Elijah. They're standing next to Jesus. They're conversing with Jesus. We don't know exactly what Jesus was talking to them about, but probably announcing to them that he is the Messiah. Just hazard a guess there. Also, Jesus couldn't be a lawbreaker if Moses is talking to him. And Jesus couldn't be a blasphemer trying to usurp God if Elijah's talking to him. But the point here, this prophecy in Deuteronomy 18 comes to us from God through Moses. And here is Moses with Jesus on Mount Tabor, according to this New Testament testimony. When the Father says, listen to him. Basically, the God and Moses, who give us Deuteronomy 18, are there on Mount Tabor to tell us Deuteronomy 18 is fulfilled in this person, Jesus of Nazareth. He is that prophet. Listen to him. Yes, and Jesus is a prophet, but he's also king. He's also priest. He's all three in himself. He encapsulates everything Israel was in himself. The way, the truth, and the life. The kingship, the prophets, and the priests, all in him. He is a prophet and more. Now, none of this escaped the attention of the early church, who through St. Peter, after the descent of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost Day, says the following. Now, what St. Peter does here, the simple fisherman who never had a real education, just hung out with Jesus. Holy Spirit fell upon him. Then, right? He sums it all up. The promise that's made to Abraham about that person, that descendant who'll be the blessing to all the nations, and that prophet foretold by Moses. And St. Peter says the following. This is in Acts 3, 18 to 25. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets that his Christ should suffer, he thus fulfilled. Moses said, "The Lord God will raise up for you a prophet from your brethren as he raised me up. You shall listen to him and whatever he tells you." And And all the prophets who have spoken from Samuel and those who came afterwards also proclaimed these days. You are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God gave to your fathers, saying to Abraham, "And in your posterity shall all the families of the earth be blessed." St. Peter sums it all up to his audience. You guys now in front of me, you are the witnesses to this. You are the inheritors of this promise. Why are you the inheritors of these promises? Because you believe in Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth is the descendant of Abraham through whom the world, the nations will be blessed. And Jesus of Nazareth is that prophet foretold by Moses in Deuteronomy 18 to whom we should listen. Now, that's not me saying Jesus fulfills Deuteronomy 18 and Genesis 22. That's St. Peter, as recorded in the Acts of the Apostles. Now, my argument here, if you're going to search the New Testament to say Muhammad is the fulfillment of Deuteronomy 18, you won't find it. The New Testament only says Jesus is the fulfillment of Deuteronomy 18 and Genesis 22. So you either got to take the whole New Testament and embrace it entirely, or ditch the whole thing. You just can't pick and choose your New Testament verses here. The Jews, through the promises made to Abraham and Moses, expected the coming of the Messiah. The Christians are those who believe Jesus to be that Messiah. The Christians saw clearly that only Jesus in his life and mission fulfilled the prophetic expectations of Abraham and Moses. They weren't waiting for anyone else. On that day at Pentecost, what we call the official birthday of the church, the Holy Spirit descends. Pentecost was that feast, originally a Jewish feast, where they celebrated the giving of the law and the beginning of the harvest season. Now Pentecost has come again. The Holy Spirit has descended upon Our Lady, the apostles, 120 people there in the upper room, because we have a new law, the law of Christ, and a new harvest, the whole world. The Christians here were not saying to themselves, "Okay, guys, Jesus has come, interim leader, going to wait, someone else is coming later." They weren't expecting someone else to come. The only person now expecting to come later on was Jesus again, to judge the living and the dead. There was no belief here among the disciples of Jesus, the prophet. If you're going to claim he's Nabi, Nabi Isa, because that's what they call Jesus, Nabi Isa, the prophet Isa. Well, his followers weren't looking for a Nabi Muhammad. They weren't. They were just waiting for Jesus to return one day. Actually, they thought it would be soon, one day in the future. There was no expectation of someone else coming from somewhere else. Is Muhammad foretold in the Song of Songs 5:16? Now, this is a bit complicated here. I'm not, and a bit of Arabic here I have to master, okay? The claim is the Prophet Muhammad is mentioned by name in the Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 16. Let's quote it here. "My beloved is all radiant and ruddy, distinguished among 10,000. His head is the finest gold. His locks are wavy, black as a raven. His eyes are like doves beside springs of water, bathed in milk, fitly set. His cheeks are like beds of spices, yielding fragrance. His lips are lilies, distilling liquid myrrh. His arms are rounded gold, set with jewels. His body is ivory work, encrusted with sapphires. His legs are alabaster columns set upon bases of gold. His appearance is like Lebanon, choice as the cedars. His speech is most sweet, and he is altogether desirable. This is my beloved, and this is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. Now, of course, you don't read this literally. This is romantic, okay, symbolic language. Okay, when it's someone swooning for someone else, okay? You take the liberty here to use this poetic, romantic language. What is the Islamic claim here? Centers around the word specifically, and he is altogether desirable. The claim is that translation is incorrect. It shouldn't read altogether desirable. I'll just read verbatim one of their claims. In the Hebrew language, im, that is I am, is added for respect. Similarly, im is added after the name of Prophet Muhammad to make it Muhammadim. In the English translation, they have even translated the name of Prophet Muhammad as altogether desirable. But in the Old Testament in Hebrew, the name of Prophet Muhammad is yet present. Now, to put it a bit simpler, what they're saying is that it shouldn't read, his speech is most sweet and he is altogether desirable. It should read, in their argument, his speech is most sweet and he is Muhammadim. Okay? He is Muhammad. Now, what do they base this on? This is the response. The response of the Hebrew, the transliteration of the Hebrew of Song of Solomon 5:16 is actually incorrect. No such Hebrew word, Muhammadim, appears in the text. The transliteration would read Mahmadim, pronounced Mahmadim. The word Mahmadim is the plural of Mahmad, meaning a desirable thing, a precious thing, from the root word Shamad, meaning desirable. Hence the reason why this word is translated as it is in the respective English translation. So the argument is, this is just a furphy. It's not a serious argument. It should read altogether desirable because that is the proper rendering in English of the word Mahmadim. It's not meant to be Muhammadim. If we were to use the word Mahmadim as if it were Muhammad's name, we would find the scriptures in other places making no sense at all. For example, 1 Kings 26, here's the quote, "But about this time tomorrow, I will send my servants to you, and they will search your house and the houses of your servants, and whatever is desirable, they will take in their hand and carry away." So there we have that word again, desirable, because we have the Hebrew word Mahmadim. If Mahmadim really meant Muhammad, then this is what 1 Kings 26 would read. "But about this time tomorrow, I will send my servants to you, and they will search your house and the houses of your servants, and whatever is Muhammad, they will take in their hand and carry away." It doesn't make sense, okay? That word Mahmadim means desirable. It doesn't mean Muhammad. Song of Solomon, or Song of Songs as it's called elsewhere, 5:16, is understood by the church as the spouse of Christ yearning for and describing Christ. All right. The next passage, we'll move to the New Testament now. John 14, the famous another paraclete. Muslims claim that Jesus himself foretold Muhammad's mission as evidence they quote the following words of Jesus as recorded in the Gospel of John. John 14:16-17. And I will pray the Father, and he'll give you another advocate to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you, and he will be in you. So the claim is, this another advocate, or paraclete in Greek, is allegedly Muhammad. Jesus is saying, well, Nabi Isa is saying, there'll be another prophet who'll come after me. He'll be your advocate at your side. God will send him. The argument goes that the Greek word in John's gospel for advocate, parakleton, and that's why it's translated as paraclete in English, some English Bibles, is a later corruption, replacing the original periklutos, which means one worthy of praise. Now, let's go back here. Remember what I said at the beginning? Muhammad, the praised one. That's what Muhammad means, the praised one. So the argument here, and get this in our heads, is that the word in Greek, parakleton, was inserted later. It's a corruption. The original word was not parakleton. It was periklutos. And periklutos means one worthy of praise. And who was the praised one? Muhammad. The Arabic for periklutos is Ahmed, one of Muhammad's adopted names. That's correct. Making Muhammad, therefore, the advocate foretold by Jesus. Let's examine this argument. Let's put it to the test. Let's also find where it was really fulfilled. One, this argument fails for the following reasons. One, the advocate is to be with you forever. So, Jesus promises the advocate to whom? The disciples and those around him right then and there, AD 30. Muhammad died in AD 632, 600 years later. He appears in 570, 540 years after the promise. It is impossible to argue that Muhammad has been with the followers of Jesus forever, because he certainly wasn't there for 540 years. Two, the advocate is the Spirit of truth. Being flesh and blood, Muhammad cannot fit the description of a spirit, let alone the spirit. The advocate is the Spirit of truth. Well, Muhammad is not a spirit, let alone the spirit. The advocate, quote, neither sees him. We can't see him. By the way, why can't we see the advocate? Because he's a spirit. He's the spirit. Neither sees him. The world cannot receive the Spirit because it cannot see him. Muhammad in his humanity was very visible. Four, the advocate was meant to be one who dwells with you, will be in you. By no stretch of the imagination could Muhammad be considered to dwell within each and every believer. What did Jesus also say about this promised advocate? Jesus promised that he would send this new advocate to the disciples, those who were immediately following him, and told them to remain in Jerusalem for his coming. Acts 1:4. Let's get this right. We have this promise in John 14. But after his resurrection, Jesus commands them to pray and wait for the coming of this new advocate. 9 days after his ascension into heaven, the new advocate arrives, as promised, in the form of fiery tongues. We read in Acts 2:1 to 4, quote, they, that is the disciples, were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Remember, the advocate would be a spirit. He'll be with you. He'll be in you. Jesus then tells his disciples later on, wait in Jerusalem, pray, he will come. Well, he comes in the form of tongues of fire. And they're all filled with the Holy Spirit. So the prophecy of Joel in 2 verses 28 to 32 was fulfilled according to the words of Jesus. In Jerusalem, upon the disciples, 9 days after his ascension, not in Arabia, on the tribe of Fir, 600 years later. It just doesn't add up. Now, the argument is the New Testament scriptures, John 14, was corrupted. The original word, perikletos, is replaced by parakleton. There was a subsequent corruption. So if there was a subsequent corruption, there must have been an authentic original. Where's any evidence of an authentic original with perikletos and then later on forgeries that change it to parakleton? What manuscripts do we have? Well, we don't have too many, but we have enough to build a case here. We have what's called the Q7 manuscript. It predates AD 70. That means Qumran cave number 7, Q7. A fragment of Mark's gospel from the Dead Sea Scrolls. We have what's called the P2 manuscript, or otherwise known as the John Wieland's manuscript, written around the year 130. Fragment of John's gospel chapter 18, discovered in Egypt in 1920. We have the Chester Beatty papyri found in Egypt in 1931. It's written around the year 155, maybe as late as 250, 180 leaves of the Old Testament, 30 leaves from the Gospels and the Acts of the Apostles, 20 leaves from St. Paul in the book of Revelation. We have the Bodmer Codex, also found in Egypt in 1955, 154-page manuscript of John's Gospel, written in Greek between 130 and 200. Contains the first 14 chapters, including this one, okay, including, you know, the advocate chapter and parts of the other 7 chapters. Then we have later codices, not manuscripts, but books, okay? From the 5th century, we have the Codex Vaticanus, Greek, Egyptian origin, from Genesis 46 to Hebrews 9. We have the Codex Sinaiticus, 4th century, also Greek. In Egypt, in the monastery of St. Catherine in Sinai, that's where it originated from, or was rediscovered there. The Codex Alexandrinus from the early 5th century. The Codex Bizet from the 5th century. Has a complete text of all 4 Gospels plus Acts, 3 John, Greco-Roman text. Codex Ephraemi from the 5th century. All books of the New Testament except 2 Thessalonians and 2 John. The Codex Amiatinus, 7th century, earliest Latin copy of the Vulgate, etc., etc. Why am I saying all this? Why is this relevant? Because there's an argument there that the Bible in John 14 was corrupted. But no matter what we have, shows no evidence of any corruption. There's no evidence of any corruption ever having taken place in John 14. All the Greek manuscripts of John predating Muhammad say parakleton, not perikletos. In fact, the word perikletos appears nowhere in the Bible. This is even so, even though among the many thousands of different ancient manuscript copies, there are textual variants existing in 78% of the verses of the New Testament alone. In other words, what I'm saying there, we've got thousands and thousands of manuscripts and codices and minuscules, that is little fragments of the New Testament, up to 24,000, we think. But none of them, in this 78% of the verses of the New Testament show variants across the board when you compare all the verses we have in those 24,000 manuscripts. Spelling mistakes, missing words, additional words, etc. But we don't have any evidence of a change from Parakletos to Paracleton. None whatsoever. What are we therefore to think about Muhammad? Seriously. I've ended that section relating to the main arguments that Muhammad is allegedly in the Bible, Old and New Testaments. What are we supposed to think? The first Christian responses to the advent of Muhammad are found in Byzantine sources, obviously, because after Muhammad dies, well, actually, there was one raid in the Byzantine Empire Muhammad ordered while he was alive. It wasn't successful. After Muhammad died, his successor was to attack the Byzantine Empire directly. So it's not surprising that the first Christian writings about Muhammad are Byzantine writings. They record him as a deceiving prophet. We have this work called the Doctrina Jacobi Nuper Baptizati, translated as the Teaching of Jacob, which appears in the year 634. Quote, what do they say about Muhammad here? Deceiving. For do prophets come with sword and chariot? Okay. The Patriarch of Jerusalem, when Jerusalem was taken by Muslim forces in 638, declared that, isn't this must be the abomination of desolation foretold in the scriptures. I'm giving you Christian opinions, early Christian opinions about what they thought of Muhammad and his followers. What does the Catechism of the Catholic Church say about Muhammad? Not a word about him personally. But it does say in paragraph 841 the following about Muslims and our relationship with Muslims. Quote, the church's relationship with the Muslims. Quote, the plan of salvation also includes those who acknowledge the Creator, in the first place amongst whom are the Muslims. These profess to hold the faith of Abraham, and together with us, they adore the one merciful God, mankind's judge on the last day. The language is very prudent. It's very balanced, very sober and reserved. It's not agreeing with the claim that they hold the faith of Muhammad. It just states that the Muslims profess to hold the faith of Muhammad. No other claim is made there. And of course, we have to be very diplomatic and prudent in how the church officially speaks with the Muslim world and how we are to speak with individual Muslims when we encounter them. Okay? If you really want people to believe in Jesus, if you really want people to become baptized and Catholic, you can't do that by insulting them and their beliefs when you first encounter them. It's not going to happen. You're just going to fortify them in their existing beliefs. You can only convert friends, people that you have won, their trust. Okay, so they'll bother to listen to you and your arguments that are put forward with respect. That's why I'm not trying to laugh during this talk. I know some of us do, I can understand at certain points, but we're not here to mock, but we are here to critique and look objectively at the claims. Then what does the New Testament say about prophets in general? Let's go back to the New Testament here. The word prophet itself appears 55 times in the New Testament. 34 times it relates directly to Old Testament prophets and names them. Moses, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Micah, Jonah, Zechariah, Daniel, Elijah, Elisha, Joel, David, Samuel, Balaam. 9 times the word prophet is used directly in relation to Jesus. 6 times directly in relation to St. John the Baptist. 5 times in relation to the false prophet of the end times. 8 miscellaneous occasions relating to a Christian prophet called Agabus, relating to Jerusalem rejecting true prophets, rewards for welcoming a prophet, or the criteria for being a true prophet. None of these 55 quotes or none of these 55 usages of the word prophet could possibly relate to a figure we know as Muhammad. Now, what verses could be used to relate to Muhammad? that some would use. I'm not saying we would use these, but some people would definitely say these verses in the New Testament do relate to Muhammad, at least by analogy. 2 Timothy 4:3-4. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own likings, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander into myths. Now, some people would use that quote and apply it to Muhammad in Islam. Personally, I wouldn't use that quote, because I think that relates to people who have heard the Christian message but and then discard it. It more relates to apostasy, which is the situation when one has been Christian and then abandons it and goes after something else. That's what it seems to me to read. And modern Western society would more satisfy what St. Paul is saying to St. Timothy there. Itching ears. We've had itching ears for many centuries, listening to all sorts of new teachings and doctrines that have just divided Christendom into tens of thousands of different sectarian groups, all contradicting and fighting each other and having their own private interpretation of Scripture, and all people going in all sorts of directions. And now that gets worse with liberalism and secularism and atheism, etc., etc. Others would perhaps apply 1 John 2, 22-23. By analogy to Muhammad. Who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, he who denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. He who confesses the Son has the Father. Now, let's look at this text. Is it appropriate to apply to Muhammad? Well, not directly, because John's speaking about problem people in his day, near the end of the first century. Gnostics, Docetists in particular, who were they? They're people who believe that Jesus came, he was divine somehow, or even if he wasn't divine, he didn't come in the flesh. The specific heretics John was dealing with were Ebion and Cerinthus. They denied that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit. Muslims accept that Jesus was miraculously conceived by the Spirit. They don't deny that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit. But the Ebion and Cerinthus taught that St. Joseph conceived Jesus like any other child. And the Gnostics believed that Jesus only had the appearance of a body. He didn't really have a body. He only appeared to suffer. And John's attacking them. They deny that Jesus has come into in the flesh. They're the Antichrist. But by way of analogy, Muslims do deny very serious teachings of Christianity. They deny that God is a father figure in the way that Jesus describes him as a father figure. The God Allah is more remote than the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. They deny vehemently that God has a son. They deny vehemently that Jesus is God in the flesh who walks among us, because their God is more transcendent, a bit more remote. Merciful and loving, yes, but no way does he mix with humanity directly. They deny that Jesus came in the flesh. That is, God came in the flesh, therefore they deny that Jesus is divine. They deny him to be the Son of God. And they certainly deny other critical teachings relating to Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection, etc. I would say, personally, there's absolutely nothing in the New Testament that relates directly to Muhammad for or against. There is certainly nothing in the New Testament that testifies to the coming of a figure that we are to expect who ends up being Muhammad. And there's nothing, however, that directly foretells or prophesies his coming in a negative way. We have generic warnings about false prophets and false teachers and deceivers and deniers and antichrists and beasts and all that, yes? But can we say that any one of them exclusively and specifically relate to Muhammad? I can't say that conclusively. So what are we to think about Muhammad and doing it in a balanced, rational, sober manner? Well, Muhammad makes the claim that he is the last and greatest of the prophets. From our perspective, we deny, we cannot accept that he is a prophet. He's not the last of the prophets because we don't accept that he is an authentic prophet from God. And we don't accept that he's the greatest because we don't accept that in his life and in his teachings, he's greater than Jesus of Nazareth. We can say that from the very evidence of what we know about Jesus in the Gospels and what we know about Muhammad from Islamic sources and using the standards of Jesus and applying the standards of that Jesus set with respect to love, mercy, forgiveness, purity, fidelity, and apply that to both Jesus and Muhammad, we cannot say that Muhammad is the greatest. In the end, when it comes to whether Muhammad is in the Bible, that is Deuteronomy 18 and John 14, it's a matter of trust. Who am I going to trust? I'm not going to trust even my own interpretation of Deuteronomy 18 and John 14. I'm going to trust the people who were the very witnesses. Who do I want to know about? Who do I want to know from about Jesus? Jesus' very followers, his direct and immediate followers, those who were called by him, who knew him, who spoke to him, who saw him suffer and die, and who saw him rise from the dead. They're the people I'm going to trust, the St. John's of this world, who saw it all, to know who Jesus is and what Jesus' relationship is with all the other prophets before or allegedly after. I will trust those men to interpret Deuteronomy 18, Genesis 22, Genesis 3, Song of Songs 5, and John 14 for me. I'm not going to trust anyone else who comes hundreds of years later, that is as many as 600 years later. Thank you very much.
Thank you for purchasing this presentation produced by Arts Media Productions. We hope you've enjoyed this presentation and share it with your family and friends. May God richly bless you.